thought of this title, or the reason why I wanted to talk about this, was that Chinno Achebe, his Things Fall Apart, for people who are familiar with the text, for people who have studied this text, it's one of the most phenomenal and one of the most seminal texts that has come out of Africa. So anybody who's studying African literature, African Anglophone literature, the first text that that person would pick up would be Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart. It's been translated into several languages. It makes for an excellent reading. It is lauded across. It makes for, you know, it's prescribed in most schools in Africa. So it has got a kind of a cult following, if one may say so. And yet there has been this criticism against Achebe, and not entirely without any reason, that Achebe talks about women as not only being sort of really subservient to the men, but also not having the kind of agency that they are required to have. This is a criticism which has been leveled at Achebe time and again. So as I take you through the presentation, I will tell you about what the criticisms are. And in fact, I'm sure many of you are familiar, if you're familiar with the text, and how I feel that given how the text is, given its time, given the kind of reception that it got, and given the kind of what Achebe was trying to do with that text, it's not as if he's actually left the women out of the text in a certain manner. There is a lot of the feminine component, but yes, of course, unfortunately, one is having to search for it rather than it being right there and for you to grapple with. So we're going to come to it. Let me introduce the text a bit to you. So this is the author that I'm talking about. His 1930 to 2013. When you see his dates, you realize that he's a contemporary author. If you want to listen to, if this lecture of mine enthuses you to pick up Things Fall Apart and read it, you must read it. It's a brilliant book. You love reading it. And then you want to know more about the author, want to know more about what he thought. So there are a lot of recordings of Professor Achebe available on YouTube, and you can listen to him. So he's one person who's talked at length about education, about the role of teacher, about he's been a professor in the US for a very, very long time. Why do you need to have a teacher? The role of the teacher as a novelist. So he's one person who has talked about all of this. And of course, he talks about his colonial status, his, that's what all his books are all about, and so on. So do go to his YouTube videos, listen to him. Believe you me, it's so much of learning that you're going to get out of them. So this is what the first Heinemann publisher in 1916, or the book came out in 1958. It was published in London by the Heinemann publishers. This was the first of their African series publications. It also interestingly coincides with the Nigerian independence. So the book came at a very happy time. Nigeria won its independence from the British, and Things Fall Apart was published in English. And it was received very well across the world, and it went on to attain its cult status. It wasn't as if this was the first English book that was written. You had other books which had been written, but none of these books that had been written earlier got the kind of reception that Achebe did, which kind of catapulted Achebe and the book status to, you know, to a level unheard of. In fact, Achebe's later books also did not kind of match up the popularity that Things Fall Apart seemed to have. It was published in 1958, the same thing that I was saying. And this was the first of William Heinemann's Limited, and became the first work published in the African writer series. And Heinemann Publishers, if you know, they are a very, very well established publishing group which publishes African authors. So the story chronicles the pre-colonial life in the southeastern part of Nigeria. And wait, how do I lose? Okay. It talks about, so what is the story about? Can I get a sense of whether the audience is familiar with the text? Then I can move further. Or if you're not, then I'll tell you a little about what the text is about.
You can, although most of the audience are from the teaching fraternity, they are faculties generally, most of them. But you can give a rough outline of the story as well.
Okay. So the rough outline of the story goes like this, that we are talking about Okonkwo. He's the central protagonist of this particular novel. And Okonkwo lives in the village of Umofia, and he's a lad who's risen to power out of sheer dint of hard work, and not for what his father had left him. And then we go on to chronicle his life, and it goes on. He has three wives, and then eventually he's sent into exile because he commits an inadvertent murder. And finally, Okonkwo dies a wrecked man. He's forced to commit suicide. Now, this entire story of Okonkwo runs parallelly with the story of the colonial invasion. And we learn about the colonial invasion also, not in a very direct fashion, but how slowly it happens. So the first instance you have of a story that somebody comes and says that the entire marketplace of Abame has been dissipated because a white man visited there, and then, you know, the events that unfold. Then slowly we are told that there is a church which gets built, and then Okonkwo's own son, Noe, becomes a member of that church. So effectively what we see is what we know, how colonialism goes hand in hand with religion. So you have that carrot and stick which works. So on the one hand, there is that carrot. If you embrace this particular religion and if you become part of this church, there are certain jobs which you might get, and there is, you know, so that carrot is dangled. And if you don't, then there is that stick, there is the district commissioner, and then there is the police, the Kothmas, who are much hated by everybody. And then the kind of terrifying punishments that are meted out by all of these people. So as far as the reception of the text, again, that I was saying, that it's an archetypal modern African novel in English, and the first to receive global acclaim. And it is by far the most favored text in the Anglophone African literature. Like I said, the minute you mention Anglophone African literature, this is one text which you're very definitely going to be talking about. And then you have the sequel. So we all know that it's Things Fall Apart is followed by No Longer at Ease and The Arrow of God in 1960 and 64 respectively. And then Achebe continues to write. He was even a short story writer. A Man of the People in 66, Antils of Savannah. And these are not Okonkwo's descendants, but that entire strain seems to continue. And effectively, what is Achebe doing? He's giving us an entire history of the colonial times to the post-colonial times, and how the how it has moved, how people who embraced Christianity, what happened of them, how people, how there was this constant skirmish between whether to embrace Christianity, whether not to embrace Christianity, how there was this, how within the societies there was a sense of coexistence which gets disrupted. And Things Fall Apart, of course, is talking about a complete disruption of a certain way of life which the people had known. And then they were called savages, and then that life was completely disrupted. So since I know my time is limited, I will not go into the discussions of the other texts, but we can always bring it up when we are in the discussion mode. So Things Fall Apart, like presumably you all know, where does the title come from? It comes from a very famous Yeatsian poem, which I'm sure all of you are aware of, The Second Coming, and which all of us have grown up reading. So turning and turning in the widening gyre, the forkhorn cannot hear the forkhorner. Things fall apart, the center cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. Very famous lines from Yeats. And Yeats is talking about how Christianity is dissipating, how the center can no longer hold, and the Christianity is dissipating, and all kinds of negative forces and rabble rousers are out there to take over. And Achebe manages to turn the whole thing around. Now, what in his interpretation of Things Fall Apart, it is the Igbo society. It is the the society, the clan, the Igbo clan, as he calls it, the kind of proud people that they were, the entire understanding of that clan, the entire entire civilization that the clan had is completely decimated by the colonial attacks. So he kind of turns this entire, you know, he takes the title from Yeats and gives it a different meaning altogether and names his novel Things Fall Apart. And this is a quote from Achebe. So all of you can read it on your screen. So this is a role that he takes very seriously, the role of that of a teacher. So he says, and here is an adequate revolution for me to espouse, to help my society to reinstate the belief in itself, to put away the complexes of years of denigration and abasement. And it is essentially a question of education in the best sense of the word. I would be quite satisfied if my novels, especially the ones I set in Africa, did no more than to teach my readers that their past, with all its imperfections, was not one long night of savagery from which the first European, acting on God's behalf, delivered them. So very, very powerful lines. And this is Achebe taking on the role of the teacher and saying that this is what his novel had set out to do. What his novel had set out to do was to inform his fellow people that, and to inform the colonizers that they were not a savage people. They were not people who needed, you know, that whole concept of the white man's burden, that we needed to come to Africa and we needed to civilize the people. Achebe puts a stop to that. He says, no, we were a civilized people. You did not understand our civilization. You imposed what you thought was civilized upon us. And effectively what you did was you wrecked our civilization. And therefore he feels the need to tell us the story of his people. Therefore he feels the need to tell us of this proud Igbo clan, which is, again, one has to remember, he's not saying my clan is perfect. He's not saying my people are perfect. He does not make that claim at all. All he's saying is that with all our imperfections, with all the negatives and positives that we had, we are and we were a very, very proud set of people with our own clannish systems, with our own ways of you know, our marriages, our funerals, and so on. But you came, you imposed, you did not want to learn. So this is what this is the message that Achebe wants to give out, and give this message out very, very strongly through his writing. Since this is a you know, I'm talking to faculty members, I don't need to explain postcolonialism at all to you. So the few books that have become the Bible, so to say. Of course, we would read The Empire Reads Back, Empire Writes Back, sorry, for the goof up. So the few books, you know, we'd read Fanon, we would read The Empire Writes Back, and I just quote a bit from here, which is again on your screen. It also covers all the cultures of the imperial processes from the moment of colonization to the present day, the literatures of African countries, Australia, Bangladesh, Canada, Caribbean, and so on. Note that the US have been left out because of the colonial hegemonic power. So the whole concept of writing back to the center. Now, the concept of you have been colonized, you have suffered, and you and your people have suffered colonization. And this is now the time when you write back in the language of the colonizer, back to the colonizer, and you're writing back to the center. And the few books which you cannot ignore at, you know, for basic reading on postcolonialism, one of course is The Empire Writes Back. And then I would also recommend you read Fanon and you read Decolonizing the Mind by Gugi Wa Thiong'o. These are some very basic readings, also for the students as we go along. So where does this term come from? I've always found it very, very exciting because we use it so much. It's a phrase which is used by Salman Rushdie, and when he was punning on Empire Strikes Back, that I always find very interesting. And so the empire is the sum total of colonies, the center being Britain, and then the writing back. Of course, this whole theory now has come under a lot of attack, and you do ask these questions that where does post-colonialism end? Because we have been post-colonial for so long, so should we have another term for it? These are debates. I'm not entering into that debate now, but I'm sure all of you are aware that post-colonialism asks questions and also asks questions of itself in terms of its theoretical position. So this whole thing that I was talking about, talking back to the center. Now, Achebe had this very interesting sort of experience of being a student in the University of Ibadan, where he read Conrad's Heart of Darkness and where he read Mr. Johnson, Joyce Carey's. And he is not able to make sense of what Conrad is writing about Africa and matching it to the Africa that he lives in. So, and then he reads Joyce Carey's Mr. Johnson, where all that the character does is, yes, sir, that mispronunciation of sir. And he realizes that he was actually laughing at in spite of being the African man himself, was actually laughing at the African man because of the way the book had been structured. So at that point of time, he felt that there was a need to have an answer to this. So he chose to write. He said the only way he could answer would be by writing and by telling people that this is definitely not the right, right kind of portrayal of Africans. This is this definitely needs correction. And therefore he goes on to write Things Fall Apart. So now we come to, so Things Fall Apart, the basic storyline I've told you, it will all come out as we go on with the discussion. So we see a lot of this gender theme playing out in Things Fall Apart, centering around the body, and centering around the masculine and feminine, body, mind, soul, rationality, mother and father. So time and again, we have instances where we are told everything is gendered. So you have a crop, the crop has a gender. Why do I say the crop has a gender? So yam is for men. The yam crop, which is the king of crops, so to say, is going to be planted by the men. The women have their own crops and those are cassava. There are stories which men tell and there are stories which women tell. There are crimes which are male crimes. There are crimes which are female crimes. And this goes on. So everything seems to be having a very interesting gendered life. And of course, in the novel, you do see it is phenomenally because it is Okonkwo's story, and Okonkwo is this, this macho man, if I may put him, describe him like that, he's a wrestler, he's tall, he's well-built, he has been a wrestling champion for a very long time, and Okonkwo does not believe in talking, he believes in allowing his machete to do the talking. So whenever it comes to, making a decision, he'd much rather take the machete out and cut the person's throat rather than getting into the conversation of it all. So you have that kind of character who is your central protagonist. And he has three wives who are petrified of him because he beats them up at the slightest occasion and so on. And hence the criticism against Achebe, that bit I'll come to a little later. So what I was talking about him being a hyperman devalues everything feminine. And this proves to be, this is my argument, that this is this, Okonkwo's death, the terrifying death that he has, where he, is forced to commit suicide. In the Igbo clan, in their belief system, if a person commits suicide, it's a crime against the earth. So then you cannot be given a burial. What happens to you is you are thrown. In fact, even his body could not be cut down by the Igbo people. They said, we will pay the British, the Kothma and whoever had come with the district commissioner to cut the body and to throw him in the evil forest. But we will not be able to give him a burial. So what led to this man who had won all these titles, who had risen to the highest level that one could within the Igbo clan, and he was forced to commit suicide. To me, when I engage with this text, I feel, of course, there is this storyline of the colonial, how the British have entered and how they have taken over, how they have brought their district commissioner and their potmas, the insult, Noe joining, all of that is very definitely a reason. But the biggest reason is, I feel, his hamartia or his tragic flaw continues to be Okonkwo denying the feminine in him. Okonkwo always believed that what he needs to project is his hyperman kind of a persona. He's constantly trying to deny the feminine. And in this process, he's dehumanizing himself often enough. And we see this more and more as we, there is a friend that Okonkwo has, a very dear friend called Oberika. Oberika is constantly talking to Okonkwo. He's the foil to Okonkwo. He's been juxtaposed to Okonkwo to show us that here is this man who understands, who does not do something just because either the oracle has ordained him to do it or he has felt the need to do it. He thinks things through. And because he thinks things through, he does not act in a rash manner that Okonkwo does. And again, when Okonkwo dies, it is Oberika whose voice breaks down and he starts crying because his best friend is no more. And then he accuses the Kotmas and the district commissioner there. They don't understand him, but he nevertheless says it, that look at what you did to such a great man. Look at what you did to the greatest man in Umofia. But that's what happened. So these are some pictures which I thought that you might enjoy. So we are going to be talking about Unoka and Okonkwo. This when I talk about the denial of the feminine. So this is the father and the son arguing, this is the wrestling match because Okonkwo. Remember, I told you he had won these several wrestling matches, and that's when. His second wife left her own husband and ran away to him to get married to him. He had been undefeated for the longest period of time. So much of the traditional Igbo life, and this is what I argue, revolves around the structures of the gender role. Essentially, all of the Igbo life is gendered, from the crops to the characterization of crimes, I've already told you. And they're also endowed with qualities which make them worthy of worship, ability to bear children, dominant roles for the women. The dominant role for the woman is first to make a good wife, for an honorable man to then be a submissive wife, third to bear as many children. And the ideal man provides for his family materially and shows prowess in the battlefield. Now, even as I say this, this has to be taken. This is a comment which needs several layers of interpretations. So when we look at Achebe's Things Fall Apart, this is the kind of a picture that we seem to get, where it's a picture more of a man who's in control. Look at the way they begin the text, and all of you will just bear with me as I read. So Okonkwo was well known throughout the nine villages and even beyond. His fame rested on solid personal achievements. As a young man of 18, he had brought honor to his village by throwing Amelins the cat. Amelins was the great wrestler who for 7 years was unbeaten from Umofia to Mabaino. He was called the cat because his back would never touch the earth. It was this man that Okonkwo threw in a fight, which the old man agreed was one of the fiercest since the founder of the town engaged a spirit of the wild for 7 days and seven nights. So you see the man that we are talking about, and you see, so when you look at the text, you feel that, you know, the roles are carved out very, very the roles are very specific. So what do the men do? They harvest, they bring in their harvest. If the harvest is good and if they are able to make more money, they can get themselves more wives. They take more wives. Then a man has his OB and the wives' OBs are all around his OBs. A successful man is one whose barn is always full and who has numerous wives and several children. What is a woman's role supposed to be? She's supposed to be submissive to the man. She's supposed to take care of his, you know, the wives divide their times when they will serve food to their husband. The co-wives kind of work that out. Cook for the husband, take care of that, the husband and their children. And a mother is revered in the society. So the mother has a very, very important position. And this is something that within the Indian patriarchal setup also we'll be able to understand that a woman is always somebody's wife or somebody's daughter. She gains in importance when she becomes a mother. So motherhood gives you a certain kind of an important position within the social structures. I, of course, do not agree with this thing which is posited, and I shall argue against it. Just a sec. How do I get rid of, somebody needs to help me here. I'm not able to see my entire screen myself. How do I do this? Okay, I've managed. Am I visible and audible both? Hello? Am I visible and audible both?
Hello, ma'am?
Yeah, am I visible and audible both?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Because I, take it.
Yes, ma'am, you're absolutely clear.
Okay, great. This is how he's introduced to us. He was well known throughout the nine villages and even beyond. His fame rested on solid personal achievements. As a young man of 18, I've already read out, he had brought honor to the village by throwing Amelins the cat and so on. So you see, the character who's introduced to us is someone right from the beginning, we are told, he is a man who has succeeded because of his sheer personal determination. And then we have another quote that was many years ago. Okonkwo's fame had grown like a bush fire in the Harmattan. He was tall and huge. His bushy eyebrows and wide nose gave him a very severe look. He breathed heavily, and it was said that when he slept, his wife and children in the outhouses could hear him breathe. When he walked, his heels hardly touched the ground and seemed to walk on springs as if he was going to pounce on somebody. And he did pounce on people quite often. And then we also get to know that he had no patience with unsuccessful men. He had no patience with his father. Now, father, like I told you before, was Unoka. Unoka was a man who we are told he's a man who was a wastrel. He didn't earn an honest man's money ever. He took several loans from various people, which he was unable to pay. But Unoka, and how the text is structured is that first you have Okonkwo's we are introduced to Okonkwo, and immediately we pass on to the father, who is Unoka. But Unoka, I argue, is a man who's different, you know, and as a person who's somewhat different from the regular people becomes a misfit in the society, Unoka, unfortunately, becomes that misfit person. He's a musician. He loves to play and he loves to travel with music bands. He's part of these traveling musical groups. He loves playing the flute. And all of this is looked down upon within the Igbo structure, where a man's worth is judged by the amount of barn, how well stocked his barn is, how many wives he has taken, and how wonderfully his OB is made. So you realize that one of the things that Achebe is very clearly telling you, that the Igbos were very centered around, they didn't have a concept of money like what happened later, but the idea of of achievement was very definitely linked to the kind of harvest that you were bringing in. And when you had good amount of harvest, you could buy yourself titles. You could pay more bride prices and get yourself more brides. Well, Unoka did nothing of the sort. And Unoka, unfortunately, therefore, so the feminine side of Unoka, which was, you know, about playing the flute, about his music, was completely denigrated within the society. And then Unoka also, unfortunately, at the end, comes down with a disease and he is not given a burial. He's thrown into the evil forest. And we are told that poor Okonkwo started without anything in life. He had a father who had put him in severe debts and he had left no young wife for him. So everything had to be earned by Okonkwo. So I had a picture of the Obi in case y'all are interested. So there would be a main Obi in the the center, and the wives' Obis would be circling this main Obi. Okay, now I wanted to bring to you another book called Efuru. This was written around the same time. This is by Flora Noapa. She's also from the same place as Achebe. And in fact, Noapa had given her book to Chinua Achebe and for getting it published. And Noapa's book is an absolutely different take. So when I say that Achebe's depiction of the women do not match with what the women writers are talking about. So Efuru, again, nobody is debunking the patriarchy. The patriarchy is very much there, but the agency, the kind of agency that women have, which unfortunately Achebe does not show, but the women authors show. So you have Efuru, the central protagonist is Efuru, and it talks about everything that the women are doing, from raising children to going to the marketplaces for earning money and so on and so forth. The one thing that you need to know about Igbo women, well, interestingly, they were not dependent on the men. It would be a very lazy Igbo woman who would have to be fed by her husband. So the women went to the fields and they sowed their crops. They sowed cassava, among several things. The women were great tradeswomen. So you see why I chose this picture for you. You have Efuru in this boat. Where is she going? She's going to the market. So the women used to be great tradespeople and they used to make their own money. And with that money, they were supposed to take care of their children, themselves, wear fancy clothes, and yes, prepare one dish every day for the husband. But there are so many instances of women who chose to live their lives, and Efuru herself, who could not become a mother. So this whole concept of motherhood also, which the patriarchal society so eulogizes, the woman is given this greater honor when she becomes a mother. The women authors, interestingly, did not want their protagonists to become mothers. So the whole concept of motherhood is debunked. You have another author called Buchi Emecheta. She has a very interesting novel called The Joys of Motherhood. And it's actually a take on motherhood, and she equates motherhood with slavery and how motherhood actually, you know, the mother is supposed to be slaving for her children and she dies a slave. And within the text, within Things Fall Apart, you do have women who are traders. It's just that Achebe does not talk very much about them. So you have Okonkwo's second wife. She goes to the market to do her trading. And that is where she meets with Chilo. Chilo is the, she's the priestess of Agbala. Well, we'll come to that. This is a very, I wanted to share this with you. This is Mami Vota. I'm sorry, I didn't write it. So this is M-A-M-M-Y-A-T-A, Mami Vata. So Mami Vata is this deity which is worshipped. So Efuru and Idu both talk about the goddess of the river. Now the goddess of the river is a very potent goddess who's there because, and you can see from what she looks like, you know, she's part female and part male. She's actually a woman deity. And the deities who worship Uhamiri or Mamivata, as she's called, people who worship her, they are very rich women. They are, you know, she's worshipped, and her women, her worshippers become great tradespeople. They become very rich, but they don't become mothers. Many of them are barren. So you have this constant you have this debunking of motherhood that is coming all the time in a very soft manner, you know. So it's very interesting. So they say that her worshippers, they rule the place. They become they're beautiful women. They are honest women. They take care of the society. They're also women with very large hearts. You know, they take care, they give money to people. Both Idu and Ifuru that Nuapa talks about are women like that. But interestingly, these women do not become mothers. So this whole debunking of this motherhood thing keeps happening. And of course, Achebe talks a great deal about mothers and motherhood, even though it is it doesn't become the prime area which he's focusing on in the novel, and I will come to that. So this is Uhamiri for you. She's the Igbo goddess of the Lake Oguta in Nigeria. She's one of the Mamivata. These are water spirits known throughout the Western and Central Africa. Uhamiri, like most of Mamivata, is usually represented as either a mermaid or a very beautiful woman. She has long black hair. She combs it with a golden comb. Although the Mamivata appear as women, their beauty shows them to be more than mortal. They have hair longer, darker, finer than mortal women. Their jewelry is so bright that it can blind the viewer. Uhamiri brings wealth and well-being to her followers, but it often comes with a price. To women who seek her, she will bring either fertility or beauty and wealth, but not both. When she appears to a man, she may ask him to promise to be faithful to her. If he is, she will bring him wealth and prominence. If he betrays her, she will take away everything he has worked for and leave him broken. So you see this incredible spirit that is worshipped. So you cannot at any given point of time within the Igbo society debunk the feminine. It is so much there, and it is so potently there. Okay, so coming back to the text, now what do we have here? You have kneeling wives. You have Noe's mother, that she's the eldest wife. There were three wives, remember? I was talking about Okonkwo had. Noe's mother does not have a name. We have instances of wife beating. We have an understanding that a wife is a possession. There is an insult that is thrown at Unoka, that is the father, that he is an Agbala or a woman. And the common insults that are constantly sort of bandied around in the text, and Okonkwo uses it quite a bit, is stop acting like a shivering woman. So this is pervasive. This is something that you see across in the text. Well, the counter to this that I have is that unfortunately, Okonkwo depicts only one part Achebe depicts only one part of the society that he saw and was familiar with. Whereas, like I told you, I gave you parallel examples. You do not have women who are these kneeling wives and who are taking their husband's beatings very patiently. And you have an example of that even within this text. So there was a lady who was beaten up. She was taken back by her own family members. And then the family members, they request for a court hearing. And the court hearing comprises of the Egwugwu, the elders of the village who dress up as gods and who dispense justice. So the Egwugwu comes, they rule in the favor of the woman, and they tell the man that if you do this, we are going to cut off your penis. So that's the kind of a punishment that is meted out. Similarly, Okonkwo's second wife, she leaves her own husband to come and stay with Okonkwo and become his wife, because she is so enthralled by his prowess as that of a wrestler. So all of this is kind of debunked. So you might have a wife who's being beaten up, but you might have so many women who will not stand for that. See, Igbo women and African women per se, the pre-colonial women, have been eulogized, and they were extremely powerful women. You have examples of women who are delivering. No woman would rest, you know. This concept of a mother resting before pregnancy, the idea was to work. And when she was going to be delivering her child, you have examples of women taking their, sickles, cutting the umbilical cord and delivering her own child, resting maybe for half an hour and then getting back to work. So when you are fierce and innocent you are fierce, you have that kind of power, you have that kind of, you're your own tradeswoman. So then to imagine that the wife would be in this battered condition seems a little difficult. So the understanding that we take from here is that, yes, it is a patriarchal world. Women do, women do play a second fiddle, so to say, to the men. But to say that she is without agency is definitely not right, is what I'm arguing. Okay. So I think I preempted myself. So Achebe does grapple with the feminine. It pervades through the novel, undercutting the strong masculine discourse. So this is my argument, that even though the novel appears to be terribly masculine, about machete, about killing and so on, but what the novel is actually doing is it is mourning the lack of the feminine. This is what is happening, that somewhere, because the focus is not on the feminine, because there is a constant debunking of the feminine, what is happening is that the novel is mourning the lack of the feminine. This is a picture of Unoka when he dies. And I told you, he died a broken man. He died a wastrel. He died somebody who had not earned any money, and he's thrown into the evil forest. Terrifying. And it wasn't just Unoka who was thrown into the evil forest. Twin babies used to be thrown into the evil forest, because twins were considered to be, it wasn't considered, the Igbo society felt that the twins, it was not right to conceive twins. So they were thrown into the evil forest. Similarly, there was a discrimination, which Achebe also talks about later. And, the discrimination with the Osus. Osus were the untouchables. The untouchables were not favored by people who were, untouchables could not shave off their hair. They grew their hair. That was the mark of their being an untouchable. And it was feared that if the Osu shaves his or her hair, they would die immediately. So these were the first set of people. So the mother with the twin, the Osus who were debarred from shaving their hair and who were treated as untouchables, these were the first set of people who went and joined Christianity. So this is another thing that Achebe shows us, that the society, okay, it was definitely not a space where uncivilized people existed. It was a civilization which deserves to be celebrated. But every civilization across the globe has its own problems. So it is, and every civilization keeps sort of negotiating with its pluses and its minuses. So within the Igbo society, there were a lot of minuses, and it is because of those that the Christian missionaries got an inroad into the society, and they were able to start their missions, and they were able to convert people, some people willingly. And the next person who gets converted, so the first person from a well-born family to join the Christian missionary was Noe. Let me come to that a little later. So I have already discussed Unoka. I will not talk about him anymore. So now we come to two other characters, Noe and Ikemefuna. Now, Noe is Okonkwo's eldest son, whom Okonkwo considers irredeemably effeminate and very much like his father, Unoka. So all along, Okonkwo keeps feeling bad that his daughter Ezinma is not a boy, because he sees greater qualities in Ezinma than he sees in his son Noe. Ikemefuna's story, I need to tell you in some detail. It's probably one of the saddest stories that we see in the novel. So there was a skirmish between two clans, and there was a girl who had been killed. To make up for that, the clan members sent to Eumophia a young girl and a young boy. The person whose wife had been killed got to keep the young girl as his wife, and the boy, because the clan did not know what to do with the boy, they brought the boy to Okonkwo and left him in Okonkwo's courtyard, and he started growing up there. So this poor boy, Ikemefuna, he was a very young child, and for days he cried and cried for his own mother, and then, very typical of how young people are, he started settling down in Okonkwo's household, and he started calling Noe's mother his own mother. And Noe and Ikemefuna became very close. And this is something that Okonkwo starts to appreciate, because he feels his very effeminate son is slowly changing because of Ikemefuna. Ikemefuna is brave, and everyone looks up to him. He's a very, very well-loved child. And then after 3 years, the oracle suddenly remembers about Ikemefuna and orders his death. Now, here is the difference between Oberika and Okonkwo. Oberika categorically, even the elder who comes to inform Okonkwo about the fate of Ikemefuna, he tells Okonkwo, don't kill him. You don't go with him because he calls you father. But he does not listen. Now, Okonkwo has to prove to the world that he's unafraid. So what he does is, next morning, he just tells his family that Ikemefuna needs to go somewhere. Noe's mother understands that, and the pot that she was holding falls and breaks, and she doesn't know what to say. Noe also understands that there is something terrible that is happening, but he can't protest either. He doesn't even know exactly what is happening. And Ikemefuna is told that we are taking you back home. Now, this poor child is quite conflicted. He doesn't know what home means for him anymore. In these 3 years of time, he's forgotten what his home was. And then they take him up to a certain distance, and there he is. They strike the first blow. The poor boy comes running to his father, Okonkwo, and Okonkwo, in fear, pulls out his machete and delivers the killing blow to Ikemefuna and kills him. After that, he's very, very sad. For 3 days, he just sits and drinks, and he doesn't talk to anyone, and so on. And then he rebukes himself and tells himself, stop acting like a woman, and he starts behaving normally once again. Now, the point that the author and everyone needs to make is that the way the clannish system worked was definitely wrong. That poor child did not deserve to die. But B, what Okonkwo has done is so completely wrong. By negating the feelings, by negating the feminine feelings in him, he wants to go out and he kills this boy who calls him father. And that is, and as his own clansmen tell him, that this is something even Mother Earth will not pardon you for. And that skirmish remains because Okonkwo says, well, I was doing what Mother Earth wanted me to do. And Noe from... dropped out. So, yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, fine. Oh. It's okay now.
Okay. So, I have to start from?
Noe.
Noe. Noe, and I was telling you that finally, so what happens to him is that he finds solace in this new religion and finds peace in the beautiful hymns that are sung. Now with Noe, they also have this this instance of him always preferring his mother's stories over his father's stories. But such was, Okonkwo's insistence that he wanted the boys to sit with him and to become men and listen to the men's stories and not the women's stories. So when he grew up and after this incident that happens with Ikemefuna, he's now so cut up with his family, though he's not able to tell anyone this. And slowly and steadily then he becomes the first person who eventually adopts Christianity and leaves his father's religion, so to say. And we are also told that this is probably Achebe's own story of his grandfather, because remember, he's himself a second generation Christian. So it could very well be somewhat autobiographical, not entirely autobiographical. Okay, so this is that terrible picture of Ikemefuna running to, and this is probably the saddest incident in this novel, where this young boy runs to him saying, "Father."
Excuse me, ma'am. Yeah. You need to share the screen.
In this particular novel, the poor boy runs to the father, says, "Father, they have killed him." The father pulls out his machete and murders him. Okay. So these are depictions of the three wives. This is the young girl who's getting dressed up to get married. So you see this, in order to show the world and in order to tell the empire that his society were not a set of uncivilized people, Achebe takes us through an entire year's life of the clan. So you have the New Yam festival, you have the marriage which is celebrated, you have a funeral which is celebrated because a very famous person dies of the clan. So this is this young bride who has dressed up. So we have depictions of how her bride price is fixed and how she does her bridal dance and how she is eventually, she has to sort of, you know, she's, the drinks are carried by the groom's family and eventually the marriage that takes place. So all these depictions and they're done with a great deal of detailing. So we have glimpses of the marriage, of the funeral, of the justice system, of the New Yam festival, of the rules and regulations that the clan has. All of this telling us over and over again, emphasizing what Achebe had set out to do, is to tell the world that his people were not a set of uncivilized, savage people. They were people who were who had a very distinct civilization. It was unfortunate that the West did not understand that civilization and dubbed them as uncivilized. Okay, so the next one. So this depiction also of the mother and the daughter, it could be anybody, it could be Ikwifi and Ezinma. So this very close, and then of course this is this could also be Chilo, who takes Ezinma and goes off into the Agbala's into the hills. So we'll come to that. There are two women, two Ikwifi and Ezinma. Even in a text which is supposed to be all about masculine valor, you have Ikwifi and Ezinma who have been depicted with some degree of care and love. So Ikwifi, like I told you earlier, she leaves her husband to be with Okonkwo and she becomes his second wife. She has a very, very traumatic life. Ikwifi's life is not very, very easy. She keeps giving birth to children, but the children die very young. All kinds of, the medicine man is called. Once the corpse of a dead child is dragged all over the place so as to ensure that this dead child will not keep coming back and troubling the mother. All kinds of things are done, but every time she has a child, the child does not live for very long. So when Ezinma is born, Ikwifi greets her, as she used to greet all her children, with a certain degree of sadness, knowing that this child will leave her very shortly. But interestingly, this child continues to live. She does not let go of her mother. She lives and she becomes a beauty. She is also her father's favorite child. Now, Okonkwo will never admit it, but every time he looks at Ezinma, he heaves a sigh and he kind of says, "I so wish she was a boy." He actually prefers her over Noe, but because of the patriarchal system, that he cannot do, because Noe is the first born to the first wife. But for everything else, there is so lots of episodes we see with Ikwifi and Ezinma. So there is an episode where Ezinma is a pampered child, because the mother was losing so many children that she pampers Ezinma. Ezinma is allowed to eat eggs, which children are not allowed to eat. And then at night, once Ezinma falls ill and Ikwifi runs to Okonkwo's hut saying that my daughter is unwell and she will die, Okonkwo immediately makes the medicine, he gives it to the daughter, and then she becomes all right. So these are moments that you see where Okonkwo allows himself to behave as a human being should. But then eventually, at all points of time, what governs him is this fear that he might turn out to be like his father. And that makes him suppress the femininity in him. And then you have this this masculinity, which is on display for the better time. So two significant episodes that happen: Ikwifi coming down with Iba, that is the fever, and Chilo the priestess taking her to Agbala's cave. Now Chilo is yet another very interesting character. Chilo is like any other normal woman who goes to the marketplace and who has a stall, but she's also the priestess of Agbala. When she becomes the priestess of Agbala and she takes on a different persona, at that point of time, everyone is fearful of her. Even Okonkwo, with all his prowess and his machete, feels scared. When Chilo demands something or does something, Okonkwo is forced to allow it, because at that point of time, she's not a woman, she's a goddess. And you can also obviously see the commonalities that we have with our culture scenarios. So the woman, as a woman, is treated in a certain manner, as a mother is treated in a certain manner, as a goddess is treated in a certain manner. It's something that we see reflected very much in our society as well. Then she takes on divine proportions and she essays the role of the priestess. And there is this occasion where Chilo comes to Okonkwo's household, picks up young Ezinma, and she walks away. Ikwifi wakes up Okonkwo and Ikwifi runs after Chilo. Okonkwo keeps telling Ikwifi not to do that, but she will not listen. She runs after Chilo and there is no stopping her. And then Chilo takes her to a place where the deity is supposed to be. She enters into the shrine of the deity. Ezinma still does not stop following her daughter because she's the mother. She will not let go. Okonkwo keeps standing there, but he's not able to follow. And then, as if everything is normal, Chilo comes out with the child on her back. She comes and she puts the child back in bed. And as if everything is absolutely normal. And at that point of time, many people have argued, and the text also makes it out to be, that this is a moment of Okonkwo's emasculation. For one minute, it is he who's not the doer, it is she who's the doer. Because Ikwifi doesn't let go of the daughter, she follows the daughter, she follows the daughter to the shrine. She's not even willing to listen to what the shrine or the goddess is saying, because at that moment, she's only a mother. She's not thinking any beyond. But Okonkwo keeps cautioning her. He's following at her wake, but he cannot enter there. He keeps standing outside. So at that point of time, you do see an emasculation of Okonkwo, and taking over the agency is completely the woman's. Okay. the way the story has been structured, even as you read Achebe, you are immediately sensitized to the fact that what you are reading is definitely a novel, which is of a different make entirely, because of the numerous proverbs, the numerous and then the way the sentence constructions are. Essentially, it is in English, but it reads like Igbo. And then again, you have these concepts of what is a male story and what is a female story. And then there is this very delightful story of the tortoise. You have the sessions of storytelling where the mother-daughter will sit together and each will tell the other a story. And each time the story is recounted, it takes on different, each storyteller adds to it. So these are instances of oratory, storytelling as it proceeds. So I won't read the entire story, but it goes on. Once upon a time, she began, all the birds were invited to a feast in the sky. They were very happy and began to prepare themselves for the great day. They painted their bodies with red camwood and drew beautiful patterns on them with uli. The tortoise saw all these preparations and soon discovered what it all meant. So this story continues, and then this is a story with a moral. So this is a story about a tortoise which was greedy, which took the birds for a ride, and how the birds eventually avenged themselves against the tortoise. And what it eventually tells us is this so-called woman's world, or so-called, when I say the woman's world, it's the mother's world. It is the world which is peopled by women, if I may put it that way. That's from where storytelling starts. I think from the day men and women started speaking, they were telling stories. So the orature and the culture of orature lies, it's embedded in the society, and you see so much of them. And it is, interestingly, it is the mother's story that we hear, and not Okonkwo's story of men and war and killing. And the story is absolutely rivetingly beautiful. And it's a story, like I told you, with a moral. So, and then you have the songs. So I was talking about the orature, which is, distinctive of cultures such as these, distinctive also of the Igbo tribe. So you have the songs of the wedding. You have the story of the tortoise, which I didn't read out the entire thing, but I read out a bit. Then you have the songs which are sung at weddings. If I hold her hand, she says, don't touch. If I hold her foot, she says, don't touch. But when I hold her waist beads, she pretends not to know. Usage of, then you have, what else constructs the oral culture? The usage of the proverbs to pepper the conversation. So what Achebe says is, proverbs are the palm oil with which the words are eaten. So just as you eat yams, you dip them into palm oil and you eat it. Similarly, proverbs are the palm oil with which words are eaten. And the entire novel is peppered with proverbs right from the beginning. So this is also something that Achebe maintains throughout the text. So what I'm arguing is, technically, even though he creates this hyper-masculine text, he's the feminine is very much present throughout the text in various forms. Okay. And then comes that phase where, Okonkwo commits a crime. And again, there is a male crime and there is a female crime. So a very important man in the society has died, and Okonkwo has gone to celebrate the death rituals along with his family. And by a stroke of bad luck, he lands up shooting one of the sons of the old man who has died. So it is an inadvertent crime, and therefore it is called a female crime. Now this inadvertent crime has resulted in this person dying. So immediately the clan has decided a punishment that he's supposed to be meted out with. The punishment is, if it was an advertent crime, he would have to pay, he would be killed. But because it is an inadvertent crime, he has to flee his land. So Okonkwo, along with his wife, had to run away from Umofia and go to his mother's land at Mabanta. And he goes there, and Okonkwo is very, very sorry to go there. He doesn't want to go there. He feels that his life is wasted because he has been given this exile. And he keeps mourning every day that he is over there. And it is at that point of time, and he's received by his uncle Uchendu with a very big heart and the entire clan. And they give him, grains and things to start his life afresh. But as the text tells us, that this is a life that he's starting without the vigor of his youth and without the enthusiasm that he had when he was young. So he lives for those 7 years in exile with a great deal of despondency and a great deal of sadness. And listen to what Uchendu says. A man belongs to his fatherland when things are good and life is sweet. But when there is sorrow and bitterness, he finds refuge in his motherland. Your mother is there to protect you. She's buried here. And that is why we say that mother is supreme. It is right that you, Okonkwo, should bring to your mother a heavy face and refuse to be comforted. Be careful or you may displease the dead. The duty is to comfort your wives and children and take them back to your fatherland after 7 years. But if you allow sorrow to weigh you down and kill you, they will all die in exile. Now, the interesting thing was that a woman would be buried in her own father's compound and not in her husband's compound. So Okonkwo's mother is buried there, which is why that constantly becomes for him his motherland. And like very beautifully said, that a man goes to the fatherland when things are good, but when there is sorrow, when there is bitterness, he goes to the motherland. Also, there was a system of what we call the age groups. So since there was, you know, how we understand people's ages are through the calendar, those days things would be, so these children were born in the year of the locust. Now these days we'll understand because we are going to face a locust attack shortly. So born in the year that the locust came and so on. So those children would bond together. That would be their age group. The age groups would have meetings. The age groups would come and do performances. So there was this constant way of remaining in touch with one's motherland and fatherland, both. And then, of course, you have, towards the close of the novel, you have the beautiful name, the explanation of the name, Neka. That's a very common name amongst the Igbo tribes, Neka. Neka means mother is supreme. And again, Uchendu, who's the eldest person in the clan, he asks Okonkwo, can you tell me, Okonkwo, why is it that one of the commonest names we give our children is Neka, or mother is supreme? We all know that a man is the head of the family and his wives do his bidding. A child belongs to his father and his family and not to the mother and his family. A man belongs to his fatherland and not to his motherland. And yet we say Neka, mother is supreme. Why is that? And Okonkwo says, I don't know the answer. And then the answer is given, now listen to me. It is true that a child belongs to its father, but when a father beats his child, it seeks sympathy in its mother's heart. A man belongs to his fatherland when things are good and life is sweet. And then it goes on, your mother is there to protect you. She's buried here. That is why we say that mother is supreme. So the central power of the mother, the central power of the mother being supreme is enunciated at the very end of the novel. Okonkwo is not ready to believe that, but because of his inability to understand and believe what could have actually been a very good time for him to spend amongst his people in his motherland, he feels sorry for himself, loses out his child to Christianity. And then when he comes back to his village, he realizes that he's lost the place that he once had in his village. Other things have happened, people have changed. And it is that realization. And then comes this very traumatic thing when Okonkwo is taken captive. He's taken captive along with four other people. They're kept in a British prison where he's tortured. He's not given any food. Their heads are shorn off and they're kind of, you know, insulted and tortured. When they come back, a meeting is called. And in that meeting, Okonkwo was very hopeful that they would want to go to war. Umofia would want to go to war. But by then, Umofia has changed. And the messenger who had come, Okonkwo, kills that messenger, and he hears people around him saying, oh, why did he need to kill that man? And that is when Okonkwo realizes that Eumophia is no longer the same. Eumophia has completely changed. And finally, last but not the least, you have Okonkwo who kills himself. And then, and this is what it says, perhaps down in his heart, Okonkwo was not a cruel man, but his whole life was dominated by fear, the fear of failure and of weakness. It was deeper and more intimate than the fear of evil and capricious gods and of magic, the fear of the forest and of the forces of nature, malevolent, red in tooth and claw. Okonkwo's fear was greater than these. It was not external, but lay deep within himself. And when Okonkwo dies, you know that he could not be given a burial. Even his body could not be cut. And Obereka mourns him. And the district commissioner can just say that he will write one paragraph. And then he says, no, even one paragraph is first. He says, I'll write a chapter. And then he says, no. And then he says, okay, I'll write a paragraph maybe on this man who was a village chief. And then he killed himself. And then I end with quotations from Achebe. One of the truest tests of integrity is its blunt refusal to be compromised. He's speaking for himself. And then he says, if you don't like someone's story, write your own. And that is exactly what Achebe has done. He felt that the stories that were written for the Africans was a story which did not do any justice to the Africans. So he wrote his own story, and that's why we get to know the Igbo civilization for what it is through the eyes of Chinua Achebe, Things Fall Apart, and the books that he has written, and other writers as well. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for making us take a journey again through one of the most canonical texts ever written and read. And few days back, we had a complete feast on Gugi. And wow, Today we had a feast on Chinua Achebe. What more can one ask for? And of course, apart from this, we already have had 3 lectures on decolonization.
So
somewhere or the other, I guess, that one of the purposes of organizing this Gnosis lecture series is achieved. So, you know, as I was saying to one of the speakers on decolonization, Lesa Molloy from University of South Africa, that somewhere I feel as a researcher, as a student, as a teacher of literature, that when I read African literature and I read Indian literature, there is something missing in Indian literature, Indian writing, which African writing or African writers has achieved. And that is, African writers have presented facts, have presented their suffering in a more original, in a more, you know, captivating way. Am I audible?
Now, yes. Your voice was cracking.
Yeah, today the internet god is playing a foul game, although it has not stopped us to enjoy this enriching and engaging lectures, of course. I don't know what's the issue, because morning generally we have very good internet, and my the calculations of GBs and recharges are already done, but somehow in Northeast, you know, weather is very unstable. So I don't know what's the issue. Although we are having not a clear sky, but we are having a cloudy sky, but a very bright weather. Yeah, ma'am. I was saying that, you know, in my opinion, as a researcher or as a student of African literature, I feel, and Indian literature, I feel that the tenacity, the depiction of human suffering, human sorrows, is more. It appears to be more truthful and more, near to the land and more real in African writers. Be it the writer paving the way of Chinua Achebe, till the present contemporary writer, Adichie, whom I consider to be one of the most powerful writers presently, Adichie I'm talking about. So it was really a feast. I had assured my participants yesterday that please don't miss the morning lecture of today, because some of you might know another name and some of you might not know, and as a host it is my responsibility, although I am too small in capacity compared to them, but it is my responsibility to let you know about the way research is research on the African literature for almost a decade now. She has been doing a lot of work on African literature. So you would be happy we had around 115 participants today in the morning, and they are still with us, and we have some interesting questions which I think you will answer in a very interesting way and very enriching way.
Thank you.
The first question is from Smruti K. Her question is, do you think that Achivi is criticizing the Igbo norms, denial of feminine qualities in men by using Okonkwo as a vehicle?
Using Okonkwo as a victim?
As a vehicle.
As a vehicle, okay. And the question came from, sorry, I missed the voice. Is
Smruti,
cracked.
Smruti K.
Okay, Smriti, thanks so much for your question. I was also reading some of your comments here. Thank you all for saying all good things. How I look at this whole business is that Achebe is, I don't think he's being critical or non-critical of anybody or anything. See, you have to understand that he, like every culture, good or bad, all cultures are evolving. All cultures have some positives and some negatives. So he creates characters as he sees them. And as he sees them, as close to life as is possible. But of course, every character is fictionalized, and therefore, you will have certain additions to the fictionalities as it is going to be. But no, he's not critical of femininity. He's just, I think what he's doing is he's probably also because of the world that he saw around him, made him feel that it was a very, very brusque, masculine world. But like I said, it has been debunked by several writers, several contemporary writers who have said that, yes, it is a patriarchal world. It still continues to be. But within the patriarchal world, you have women with great agencies. I don't know if I answered you right. Actually, Shoykot's voice is cracking, so I'm not sure I'm hearing him properly. So that is the other problem. Or you all can write it in the chat and I can see, or I don't know.
We also have introduced a facet of this nonsense lecture series, ma'am. After the lecture is over, we will mail you the questions.
Okay.
And you can please type it and, revert it back to us at your free will. And we will get this, 3-4 speakers per nonsense issue. We will get it published from the host community. So that will be also given on the website. So they can, see to it whenever they are free. They know the website, the participants. And they can see in the forthcoming series of Gnosis. The next question is, ma'am, from Dr. Navneet Negi. She is an assistant professor of Satyavati College, University of Delhi. I quote her, "Wonderful and captivating presentation, ma'am. My question is, can we analyze the text as misogynistic since Achivi in the text uses language in certain ways to glorify masculine gender while portraying the female gender as docile, foolish, weak, and irresponsible second-class citizens?"
Thank you, Navneet, for the compliment. No, I would not go as far as to call it misogynist. I would say that he tries to depict what he saw in the society. But misogyny would be if the women were hated. But you look at the women. Ikwifi, Izinma, even Noe's wife, do you hate her? She might not have agency. What troubles you and me as feminists, as aware women, is that why did Noe's mother not protest? Why did she not do anything? Why did she only allow that pot to break and that was that? But there were so many things that were working. Primarily, what the oracle ordains is not for any human being to debunk. You know, you cannot question the oracle. The belief systems are so strong that you are not allowed to question the oracle. And within the social structures, you have women, you do have these kneeling wives. She will drink after the man. She will kneel and drink. But you also have the positions that women have. So you have the first wife. She wields quite a strong position, and she and it's a position of power, which unfortunately we do not see Noé's mother wielding, but technically the first wife is a powerful woman. And you also have, like I told you, women who are traders. So it is mentioned in the passing that they had a stall. It's not developed. What instead is done, actually what Achebe also is doing is he's actually critiquing this hyper masculine quality that Okonkwo has. You know, look at Obirika, the fact that Obirika is constantly questioning Okonkwo, even though he's his best friend. So Obirika tells Okonkwo that yes, the oracle has ordered, I would not stop it, but I wouldn't be the person to do it. But Okonkwo takes it to the next level because he feels he should not be his father. His biggest fear is that he might become like Noé. He might become like Unoka. And everything about Unoka is something that he hates. So basically, he is fighting an inner demon. And remember that time when he beats up his wife during the week of peace? Everybody critiques him for that. So it's not as if women really were such peripheral characters as is shown. So I would not use the word misogynist. Yes, justice was definitely not done to the women. The way they should have been depicted has not been depicted. But for that, what we may also see is that, you know, we cannot judge a writer based only on one work of his. You do have subsequent works of Achebe, and you do see very powerful women in those works. So Things Fall Apart, yes, lacks in that powerful woman's voice, which probably Gugi presents before you, which Achebe does not. But probably Achebe, being the chronicler of his society, maybe that is what the society that he was seeing was what he was depicting, is how I would look at it. But of course, you know, we can. But misogynistic, no, I wouldn't agree.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Sovan Chakravarti's question. Things Fall Apart is one of the most important testimonies of African anti-colonial struggle and post-colonial thinking. The woman question in these contexts, do you think that they, although all start and are built up on home, woman and feminine, eventually patriarchy arrests and engulfs the whole movement? The same has been pointed out and deliberated by some of the post-colonial feminist and subaltern historians in our context. What's your opinion?
Yeah, I would tend to agree to a great extent, yes, because the patriarchal structures are so strong that you cannot debunk patriarchy entirely. But where I also parallelly argue that within the framework of patriarchy, you can debunk patriarchy. If I may, Shoykot was talking about Indian authors, so let me bring an Indian author and a Bengali author who I'm sure Shoykot would have read. Many of you might have read her in translation. So a writer like Mohasheta Devi. Now, she talks about, say, a Rudali. Now, this Rudali is this woman who gets money out of crime. In Rajasthan, it's a prevalent thing. So some very important person dies, a Rudali is called, and Rudali goes and cries, and she earns money out of it. Now, in Mahasheta's delineation of a Rudali, this Rudali is a woman who can't cry. So we begin with having a character called Sanichari who can't cry. So Sanichari does not cry. She loses her husband to poverty. The mother-in-law keeps abusing her. And then she's yet takes care. So it's a terrifying life. Her son leaves her. But all along, this woman is not able to cry. And then she's at the very end, she finally gets a friend. Even the friend dies. So that huge sorrow and sadness, and then she's dying without food. So at that point of time, she's advised to become a Rudali, and she's wondering how she can become a Rudali when she can't even cry. She gets her daughter-in-law, an errant daughter-in-law who had left her. The women gang together and go and cry at this, you know, this rich person's funeral. Now, it is to be read on so many layers, you know. So here is this man who would have raped so many of them. They cannot outwardly debunk the man. But here they are crying and screaming and screeching and getting more money. So, you know, it's a, how do I say it? Now, the patriarchal framework has not been breached. It is near impossible unless, you know, you have this hyper-feminist person. So within the patriarchal scenario, here are these women who are actually doing this whole enactment of being these Rudalis, getting them to pay extra money for them. And, no, that is their revenge against the Seth. So I don't know if you're able to understand me. Do you get my point? That the rebellion does not always have to be of some hyper feminine kind. The rebellion can also be, a woman can show agency within the very patriarchal confines also, as is seen in many Indian texts and in many African texts. So that's how I feel.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Rashmi Gupta, an assistant professor from MSIT New Delhi. Her question is, what did Achebe want to portray through Okonkwo's death at the end?
Primarily, of course, garner sympathy for the man. He's the lead protagonist. Secondly, of course, to show. So Okonkwo also resonates and resembles the Igbo culture system. So the complete collapse of that, you know, and how the death happens in such a terrifying manner. Here he can't even be given a burial. It's a very, very sad thing. It's a very tragic end, which is why I was talking about Hamashiya and all in the beginning, that there is a tragic flaw and there is a tragic end. So to emphasize the tragedy and to say that, and it ends with us being told one of the greatest Igbo men has died, and he dies a dog's death. So, and what are the factors responsible for the death? It is everything. It is the colonialism. It is his people turning against him. It is the change that has happened within the Igbo society, and his son deserting him. So all, everything accumulates into him having this, you know, this death which cannot even be mourned. And what can be worse than a man who could not be celebrated in life and who could not be celebrated in death? Remember, Okonkwo had taken so many titles. He was going to take the last title and the most important title when he commits that inadvertent crime, and he's given that, you know, he's sentenced to exile. 7 years later, when he comes back, the society around him has changed. So it is the death of the clan. It is things fall apart, center cannot hold. That's what the end denotes for me.
And when you gave the example of Mahasweta Devi, I also would like to inform the participants, although I've shared your bio, that you have worked on Mahasweta Devi's works as well. And I feel that the writers writing in non-English language, the Indian writers, they are more powerful writers. We recently had a session of Dr. Shreya Bhattacharya, who talked about Jacintha Kargatta from Jharkhand. So, you know, what I feel when I went to Indian writing, that time when I was comparing it with African writing, I meant by the Indian writers in English.
Yeah.
So, I think the other writers, non-English writers, I will never term them as regional writers, non-English writers, they are more powerful in India as compared to, you know, slyly I feel the Indian writers in English have taken a very sly route and somehow has not achieved that kind of excellence that the African writers have done, in my opinion, although people might disagree.
I think somewhere I agree with you, Shoikot, also because the repression that was faced by Africa was much greater than what we faced. So
I think one of the reasons, just to interrupt and so that you can add more to your thing, Africa comparatively, I think, was not as diverse as India is. So I think because of this diversity, Indian diversity of culture, tradition, language, food, the penetration of colonialism did not have that much of effect. Although Africa was also diverse, but not as diverse, in my opinion, as India's geography and language and culture. So I think that penetration which lacks in India by the colonizers compared to the Africa, one of the reasons is the diversity.
I will not agree with you on that, Shoykot, because Africa is hugely diverse. There are so many regional languages, and there are so many tribes, and so many tribes within tribes. So it's hugely diverse. The difference what happened was, in India, we had written texts. So British, the British had a very interesting way of understanding things. History had to be written down chronologically. Anything that you had to be written down. So if you have a written text, you somehow survive. You know, in case of Africa, what happened was everything was oral. It was an oral tradition. So the oral traditions got completely decimated. And like I was telling you, how does an oral tradition progress? So from one generation to the next, storytelling, even in our cultures, we had Shruti and Smriti. So you hear something, you remember it, and Shruti, Smriti, you pass it to the next generation. But we had written texts. So some are, whatever our wisdoms were preserved there. So it wasn't possible to sort of say that there was no civilization. Whereas in Africa, it was like a complete decimation. And takeover by the gun. People were shot, completely taken over. So it was actually a very devastating thing. And then, therefore, these kind of books were also being written. And look at then what Achebe says, that he, the African, is sitting in the classroom and being told how stupid Africans are. Is when he thought that he needs to write a book. That's happened with us also. But we somehow still felt that we can write art for art's sake. That concept has been completely debunked by African writers who do not write and who do not have the luxury for writing for art's sake. Because the sufferings have been so much more, art has to resonate with the politics of the times. It does for us also, but it does in a latent fashion. But there it has to be on a more immediate situation because the sufferings have been 10 times more. So it is like, Shoykot, what I would say, if you were to ask an Adivasi person in our country to write a book, would that person write an art for art's sake kind of thing? Or would that person write about what that person was suffering, what that person was going through? So the immediacy of the suffering, which maybe some Indian writers never thought to do. And that's probably where the difference is, not in terms of the diversity. The diversity is very much there. It's hugely diverse. We just know Anglophone Africa. We don't even know the Francophone Africa. And then there are tribes and tribes. Within the same tribes, different languages are spoken. So it's a very, very complex situation. So we cannot, it's not a uniformed kind of a whole at all. Even though we only study one portion of it.
Very, very aptly put. And I think this will give, I will explore this angle of yours. And definitely this has given me a direction, which ultimately is one of the, reasons of holding this Gnosis lecture series, because I have spoken to some of the African scholars that why do you think the African writers are so strong? So, they speak what they feel and they are so, I would not say brutal, but they are very realistic depiction. So one of the points that you mentioned will definitely add a new dimension to my research on African literature. That is, as you rightly said, that we had texts to govern us. We had text which we can look up to, and we had that for us kind of thing. But the Africans, because of that paucity, because of non-availability, because of nothing in written form, and I can beautifully correlate what you said because I was witnessing Dr. Shreya's ma'am's presentation that day on this in the course. So I can very well understand. I can correlate what you intended to mean. Thank you very much for giving me that angle of thought, and that will definitely enrich my understanding and my exploration of this particular field. So thank you very much, ma'am. Next is a question from a PhD scholar from Department of Women's Studies, University of Madras, Swethal Ramachandran. Her question is, what if the context of this novel was shifted to a matriarchal clan in Africa? Do you think Achille would have tried to portray it fairly?
Boycott, I'm not able to again hear you. Your voice is cracking.
Just a second, ma'am. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, now you are.
Ma'am, a PhD scholar from Department of Women's Studies, University of Madras, Swethal Ramachandran, her question is a very interesting one. What if the context of this novel was magical planet? Do you think HEB would have tried to portray it fairly?
I only got the last bit. What is the, and then I didn't get anything, and then Achebe would have, again, can you repeat it? I'm sorry.
What if the context of this novel?
What is the context?
Was shifted. What if the context of this novel?
Was shifted.
Was shifted to a matriarchal clan in Africa.
Yeah, oh, that's a lovely question.
Do you think Achebe would have tried to portray it fairly?
I love the question.
Yes. It's a very interesting one.
Yes, it's an interesting question and probably the point that I was trying to make. So I have this theory. Of course, all of you can feel free to debunk it. I always feel that a male writer and a female writer write very differently. A male writer would, not to take away from male writers and not to take away from writers who depict women very, very beautifully and very thoughtfully, but very often I've seen there is that slight difference. And yes, if it were a matriarchal society and Achebe was talking about it, maybe he would have depicted it differently and he would have been forced to depict it differently. But forget about a matriarchal society, even the patriarchal society, which has been talked about by women who are Achebe's contemporary. So like a woman like Flora Nwapa, I was talking to you about. In fact, about Nwapa, they did not read her books. Women writing in Africa, forget about other things, Shoikot and others, let me give you this other trivia. Women writers in Africa were writing from the same time as men writers were writing. But their books were completely ignored, because they were supposed to be women's stories. And they said, oh, there are too many women and all the women are talking. That's how Nwapa was designated. You know, too many chat sessions by women. So there's no point in, there's nothing more to the text. It came to such a point where when there were literary meets happening, women were not even published. It came to such a point that women writers, very well-known writers like Amata Aidu, Grace Ogot, they actually started saying that for heaven's sake, critique us as much as you want, but read us. Do not ignore our works. So, there has been this huge politics of publication. So yes, when you ask me this question, so if it were a matriarchal society, would Achebe have written differently? Yes, he would have written differently. But would he have written as feelingly? We don't know. Let me give you yet another example, which will maybe bolster what I was saying. So I'm sure all of you know about the terrifying, immediately, and Shoikot was just talking about Adichie, so he would have read about it. So immediately after the independence came this very, very traumatic, civil war that happened within Nigeria. And that has been talked about by everybody because it was ghastly. People were killing. So till now, you had one enemy, which was the white. Here, people were fighting amongst each other. So that was traumatic. That was absolutely terrible. Now, when the war is happening, Nwapa has a book, which he calls very interestingly as Never Again, which means no more war, never again. And what are they doing? Now, when you read about it from a male author, they're talking about how the guns were being procured, how the where the fights would be organized, how the fights were happening, what was happening, so on and so forth. What was she talking about? How would she get meals for her two children? Where were the meals to be arranged from? How, there was these border tradings that used to happen. So the women would go out and get some petrol. They would go and get some sugar. And so, you know, small stories, nothing very great. Buchi Emecheta, of course, has a story of a woman with a gun who goes and fights. But Nwapa's stories are about these small kind of things, which I think you and I will all relate straight away. And while this whole war is going, she's not going into the hyper narrative of the war. Her narrative is she's just seeing where to get the meals from, how to get some food from there, how to get the petrol, how to drive the car, how to keep the family running becomes her concern. And that is such a valid concern. And through that, she's also talking about the meta narrative of the war and dissing it. You know, she's critiquing it. That what was the need for that war where so many people are suffering? Who is the winner? What was the, so the whole logic of war is also being questioned. The meta narrative. So yes, a difference for sure. I hope I answered you well. I took you to many different directions to make you evaluate the things differently.
I will share the, your email ID. You had already shared in the first slide, but I will still share if you can. If you have any questions to Nandini ma'am, you can directly approach her, or you can give me also. I will put it in this question list and she will be, I'm sure she'll be happy to answer those questions. I will take the last question for the day today. Very upcoming budding scholar, Sampriti Bhattacharya. She is a postgraduate student from Presidency University, Kolkata. Her question is, and that is also a very interesting one. Does Achebe, who tries to depict the Igbo life with authenticity, perform the same kind of violence on women that Conrad does on Africans in Heart of Darkness?
Again, Shoykot, you'll have to repeat yourself. I don't know, your voice is cracking towards the close of it, so I'm not able to hear the end of the question.
I'll just, am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, the first part you're always audible. Towards the end, it kind of something happens.
Yeah, something has happened. I don't know what. I hope the Igbo people are liking it. does Achebe, Sampriti Bhattacharya, a postgraduate student from Presidency University, Kolkata, her question is, does Achebe tries to depict Igbo life with authenticity, perform the same kind of violence on women that Conrad does on Africans in Heart of Darkness?
I got you. Yes. Hi. So, no, I wouldn't say that. Conrad, again, see, we have to perspectivize given the person's place and space. Conrad was writing from his place and space as a person who belongs to, the colonial race per se. When he goes into a space like Africa, these could very well have been his thoughts. And he writes from that space. Achebe too is writing from his space. So no, he's not taking away from the dignity of women. Like I said, you also have to evaluate a writer. You have to see him, A, from his time and his space, and then the writings that he has done. So you have so much that Achebe has written. So I think it would be entirely wrong for us to just take one text and use it as a stick to beat Achebe. No. Like I said, I personally am a huge fan. Why am I reading this book? Why am I talking about this book? Both the men have been true to their craft in their own ways. As literary critics, we have every business critiquing them, problematizing them. But again, I would say, also judge them by their literary merit. And so I would never use a term like misogynist for Achebe. No, not in the least. I would say it could have been a more balanced novel, which I missed. I do miss the balance in Things Fall Apart. But I think towards the latter works of his, he has tried very hard to restore the balance in so many ways. And then we have to, like they say, give the devil his due. Maybe this is what he was seeing before him. And he depicted what he saw. So if he was seeing, let us suppose the society that we live in. So now we have domestic helps who have helped us all our lives. Today I have a profession and today I can sit in front of you and give a 2-hour long lecture because I have somebody else taking care of my house. Then came the coronavirus. The domestic helps were shunted out. And then some apartment complexes allowed them, but most are saying that we don't want them to come because we are scared. Almost castigating an entire set of people to disease carriers, which we know they are not. This is a rich man's disease. This is not a poor man's disease. But look, in our class caste consciousness, how conveniently we have put it on the caste and class of people whom we consider to be the other. So if I am writing today and trying to be very honest to my craft in terms of its depiction, I will talk about what I see around me. That might be, at a later stage, someone might say, oh, she, talked about this in this manner. And, so like I say, so therefore, as scholars, we need to take into consideration the person's time, the person's place, and the entire oeuvre of his work before we come down and critique. But yes, having said that, as a student and teacher of literature, we have every business critiquing every work that comes.
Thank you so much for so descriptively answering each question. And if you see the chat box, Swetal has already typed that. Thank you very much, ma'am, for so descriptively and so sincerely answering my question. And we already have, I'm happy to inform you that we had and still have audience from Nepal, we have from Bhutan, we have from Saudi Arabia, we have from Philippines. In the due course of time, we also are having from time to time from South Africa, Belgium. So this Northeast lecture series, the speakers, the credit goes to the speakers who, are raising the bar. Each speaker is raising the bar, coming and speaking. Thank you very much for sharing your valuable time. And today's presentation was a very meticulous, enriching experience, ma'am. Thank you once again.
Thank you
for accepting our invitation. It was a pleasure to have you, ma'am. And take care. And please, if possible, do join us for future sessions if you have some time. I know you are completely stuck up with various kind of conferences. You recently hold a very successful conference. I saw 57 papers presented and, it was a very successful one. I somehow managed to join in one of the sessions. So congratulations for holding such a beautiful conference on women. And I think it was on women, gender. It was good conference, ma'am. I'm happy that I could at least go into one of the sessions. And I was listening to some of the budding research scholars. I feel the research scholars are very interesting and challenging.
And some excellent papers from young colleagues and research scholars and students. And I think you all are the backbone. I mean, so much fresh blood is coming in and so much fresh research is coming in. Makes me so happy. So yeah, please, all of you, remain connected. Thank you so much, Shoikar. And remain connected. If I have your contact details or I can access you through Shoikar. We keep planning something or the other. Since all of you are showing an interest in African studies, there is something that we were planning. Maybe Shoikar and I get together or some other friends. Because this is an area which I love, as my presentation would have shown you.
Me too, completely.
So I
would just inform Unosis, one of the special issues were edited as an issue edited by Nandini ma'am in 2017 African literature.
I've also had the good fortune of meeting both Professor Achebe and Professor Gugi in person. I can't even begin to tell you what an honor it has been. Several friends from Africa, we collaborate for various things. So yes, we'll be very happy to do something and we'll keep you guys in the loop. Thank you so much. Thanks, Shilkar.
Thank you. Absolute pleasure, ma'am. Take care. Thank you, participant, for sparing your time. This is Dr. Shilkar Banerjee signing off for now. 5:30, we have the next session today. Thank you so much.